Good evening and welcome to our last webinar in our webinar series on distance learning and access with TOTOS. My name is Amy Chow and I am Casio's National Training and Product Manager. As a longstanding member and supporter through scholarships with TOTOS, we are proud to partner with them on this new webinar series. For the sake of webinar quality, we are keeping everyone muted and all videos turned off except for the presenters and moderators. If you have a question or comment, please type it in the chat panel and make sure to send it to everyone. This webinar is being recorded and will be available on Casio Education's YouTube page and TOTOS's website. Additionally, a certificate of attendance will be available upon request. And now we have Aaron Silvis from TOTOS to introduce our speaker. Aaron?
Thanks, Amy. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of TOTOS, I would like to welcome you to this distance learning session. And thank you, Casio, for partnering with TOTOS on this series. Can you hear me? Engaging English Learners Online will be presented this evening by Maya Gueron. Sorry, Maya. Maya was born and raised in Falls Church, Virginia. She's been supporting English learner instruction in Fairfax County Public Schools since 2012 and currently serves as the ESOL Department Chair at James Madison High School. A child of English learners, she's passionate about achieving educational equity for all learners. Thank you so much, Maya. We can't wait to hear from you, and I'll pass it off to you now.
Thanks, Aaron. Let me go ahead and share my screen. All right. Hi, everyone. I'm Maya. Thanks for spending part of your evening with me tonight. I want to kick things off with a TikTok video. The TikTok video that inspired tonight's chat. Maybe you can relate to it.
Jonathan? Jonathan, are you there? Are you here? Jonathan, can you hear me? Are you with us? Jonathan? Jonathan, are you there?
All right, so I have to ask, how many of you can relate to this TikTok? I'm gonna ask you to respond in this Zoom poll here. Oops, if I can find it. All right, we have a few yeses, quite a few yeses. Well, I can certainly relate, but fortunately I have found some tips and tricks to connect to the other side, so to speak. So that's what I'm gonna share with you tonight. If you're curious, here's our poll results. But yes, I wanna share with you some specific strategies and routines I've learned to help beginner English learners, specifically WEDA levels 1 and 2, to engage in deeper online learning. And I hope you find something tonight that you like, that you're willing to try in your own class, so your English learners feel comfortable using their voice to participate in your class. You're welcome to engage with this learning opportunity in whatever way it works for you. Here are some options. I just ask that you stay involved, engage by using our chat, our Padlet, or the reaction buttons that you see at the bottom of your Zoom screen. I'll also drop the link to this Padlet in our chat. You'll see here it's organized by the four topics we're gonna talk about tonight. And you know, I'm so sorry, I can't find the chat. Well, I think there's just enough of us here to actually make sharing in the Zoom chat a lot easier. So I hope you'll consider doing that as we move through our agenda tonight. In fact, b- before we get into our four topics, I'd love to know who's here. So if you'd be so kind to introduce yourself in the chat, let us know who you are, what your role is, and what experience or interest you have in working with English learners. Hi, Karen. Thanks for sharing. Hi, Erin. Hi, Michael. Hi, Kendall. Hi, Linda. Hi, Sylvia. Hi, Nora. Hi, Remy. Awesome. Thank you all so much. It looks like we have a wide range of expertise in the room, which is awesome. So I look forward to hearing your ideas as we work together tonight. I look forward to learning alongside you. So let's go ahead and get started with building community. I start here because this is really the foundation for all learning. We all need a sense of safety and belonging if we're going to engage with and learn from other people. Obviously, it's much harder in a virtual setting when we don't have that physical community space to convene in. But that's why we as online teachers have to make a special effort, not just to find new and creative ways to teach, but really to just give our students a reason to get up in the morning, especially our high school students. They're not coming to school to learn the quadratic formula. They're coming to see their friends. They're coming to see you. They're coming for relationships. So if you make one priority in really cultivating your online teaching, make it be those relationships, make it be creating a space where every student feels valued and safe. And the easiest, simplest way to do that is to greet each of your students by their preferred name and preferred pronouns every time you see them. I know this seems like a very obvious idea, but I take the time to say it because it's actually easy to forget. We are asked to do so much as teachers. We're juggling a million balls. We probably have a million tabs or windows open at any given time. So it's actually easy for a student or even several students to slip into a class unnoticed, especially if they arrive after the class has started. Very common. The problem is students who find they can enter a class unnoticed, notice, and they get the message very quickly that their presence in that class doesn't matter. We have to show them otherwise. So no matter how deep into the lesson you are, or even if you're mid-speech helping another student, I invite you to stay alert. And when you hear that little ding of someone entering your classroom, to take a moment and greet them by name. It literally takes a second, but it makes a huge difference because it shows them that you see them and that you care. Obviously, saying hi is just the beginning of a relationship. We also want to show our students that we care about the things they care about. I'm sure you all are familiar with these picture prompts, which are a great way to start the day and get sort of a snapshot of your students' mood. I'd ask you to consider, when you do these daily check-ins, to go a step farther and actually talk with your students about what's going on in their lives. And that includes the happy stuff, like, what are your weekend plans? To stuff that's not so happy. Stuff that's actually hard to talk about. Things like the recent shootings in Atlanta. These are the things that your students are thinking about and that many of them are actually living through. And it's our responsibility as teachers to acknowledge that and to meet our students' needs as they're living through these moments. It's also the foundation of building a real and meaningful relationship. So go beyond the meme, so to speak, and talk with your students about what's happening in their life outside the classroom. In addition to those informal conversations, I also ask my students to fill out this short Google form every morning. It covers everything from sleep to food security to technology access. And I read the responses as they come in, so I can follow up immediately by private chat. And this helps me make sure all my students' basic needs are being met. So this is one way I stay connected with my students. I'd love to hear from you. If you could tell me in the chat, how do you know how your students are doing when you can't see them face to face? Emoji check-ins are awesome, super quick too. And they have so many choices, which I love. I feel like I get a good sense of students' personalities based on what emojis they use. Cool, so that's short surveys as well. Yeah, I do think the daily use is important. We care about our students every day, not just when we have the time, right? So these are all great ways to build that student-teacher relationship. We'd be remiss not to mention, though, peer relationships. Peer socialization is such a huge part of the school experience, an important part of student social and emotional development. And in the online world, when students don't have that ability to spontaneously meet up on the bus or in the cafeteria, again, we have to make a special effort to make time and space in the online class for students to connect. So I'm going to show you a few ways that I've incorporated peer talk in my class. The first is this group chat routine. Students are, this is something we did on the very first day, and as the name implies, something we do regularly throughout the year. Students are put into small groups of about three students, and they're tasked with asking each other questions, like the ones you see here. Then they record their answers on a collaborative document, in this case, a Google Slides. And finally, we come back to the main group to share out. And these are the sentence frames I project for my students to see. You'll notice that when I ask students to share, I'm asking them to share about another person in their group. I think there's very few of us, adults and native English speakers included, who enjoy talking about ourselves in a large group. It's a lot easier to talk about someone else. So that's what I ask my students to do. I call on them by name, and I invite them to share on the microphone what they learned about someone else. And I must say, I don't think I've ever had anyone refuse to answer using this routine. obviously, structured conversation like those can feel a bit stilted, and they're not what people usually engage in normal life. So I also like to give students time for unstructured conversation each class. I find that the best way to do this is before playing team games like Quizlet or Kahoot. Rather than start the game immediately, I give students a few minutes to just settle in and talk about whatever they want to talk about in whatever language they want to talk in. And depending on the group makeup and depending on where you are in this process of building your class community, the groups might be quieter or rowdier depending on the day. If you are noticing that a breakout group is dead silent during this free time, obviously you have a choice to just let them be. But if you really want to cultivate, again, those peer relationships, I recommend jumping into those groups and getting the conversation started. I also drop into the group these social conversation starters, like the one you see here, because I find that once students have gotten started, once they find that they have something in common, usually they'll run with it, and usually they'll be able to carry on the conversation on their own. Of course, I don't want my students just to develop social language. As a teacher of English learner, we also have a responsibility to make sure they're having opportunities to develop academic language. So I'm going to show you a few routines I use for that purpose. I will just take time, though, to emphasize that all the routines I'm going to show you tonight are specifically designed with beginner English learners in mind. And they're specifically intended to invite those students to engage in deeper mathematical learning. I say that because there is a great temptation when working with beginner English learners. Again, I'm thinking of those WEDA levels 1 and 2, to water things down, especially in math. There is a temptation to stick to the surface level procedural facts. But we wouldn't do that with an honor levels class. So we shouldn't do it with our English learners, not if we're interested in really achieving educational equity and making sure all our rare students have meaningful learning experiences. So just remind yourself, I have to remind myself too, that using simplified language doesn't have to limit you to simple ideas. So here are some examples of how I encourage my students to really engage critical thinking skills in math. The first is, which one doesn't belong? Oh, that's a great point, Karen. Sorry, you guys are making awesome comments and I'm so distracted. Yes. Yeah, I love thinking about math as language. It certainly is. So that's why these sentence frames are so helpful. I'm sure you are familiar with which one doesn't belong. I wanted to show you how I adapt it for my level one students. And you'll notice that I intentionally start with a prompt that is not content specific so that students can really bring their background knowledge and experiences to the table. We don't stay here though, very quickly. And again, this is something we start right at the beginning of the year and continue to use throughout. When we are working with content specific prompts, I do recommend a three-step procedure. So the first step is vocabulary. You have to give students that tier three vocabulary they need to talk about what they see on the screen. I find it's helpful to have a digital word wall or Quizlet study set for every unit posted on the very top of your class webpage somewhere that's easy to access so that students can pull it up quickly and easily every day. Because obviously it's that exposure and it's that use of the vocabulary in context that's gonna allow them to really learn it. Step two is think time. I like to give students 1 to 2 minutes to think quietly about the prompt and then invite them to record that thinking anonymously in a Pear Deck or Jamboard or Padlet. Again, something where they have the freedom to organize their thoughts without the pressure of an audience. Finally, we share out. And the beauty of using a Jamboard or Padlet for that second step, that writing to think step, is that when you get to the share it phase, just like we did in the group chat, students have the option of sharing what another student has written. And this means that you're gonna get a lot more responses from students because once again, it's always easier to talk about someone else. Of course, you wanna encourage students to share their own ideas, but if they don't feel comfortable doing that, that's okay. The point is you want them to participate and you want them to learn from each other. Another routine I love for cultivating critical thinking skills and academic language is error analysis. For this routine, I use the classic I do, we do, you do procedure. So I start by modeling a problem for the whole class and thinking aloud. Then I split the students into breakout groups where they work on 2 to 3 problems as a group. So this is what they see. These are the directions. Once again, specific sentence frames, so they know exactly what language they can use in each setting. And then the problem itself. So here you can see they're asked to identify the error and explain how to correct the error. And they have space to show that. And this is, of course, in a collaborative document where every member in the group can write, and which I can see as well and comment on in real time. So as students are working, again, I'm drifting between the groups, monitoring, facilitating, and drawing students into the conversation. Once everyone has had time to work through their problems, we come back to the main room to share out. Finally, after everyone has shared, each individual student is asked to use that same academic language, that same protocol to perform error analysis on a problem of their own. And this is a great space, a great opportunity for differentiation. I handpick a problem for each student so that I know it's in their optimal learning zone. And I give them the same directions they saw in the group setting. So this is what they see on Google Classroom. Again, the same directions, but this time they have their own slide and their own problem to work through. And again, I'm there commenting and working it through with them in real time. Once the student has had time to work it out, we've come to a consensus, then I ask them to record themselves explaining their problem, which I'm gonna show you an example of right now.
Hello, this is my problem. My problem in the error is the answer because negative 22 plus 22 in both sides is equal 0. And each time here, 3x minus 3x, and that is grow and square. Is the answer to solve this problem correctly, you need 3x minus 3x in both sides is 0 equals 0. Thank you.
All right. Not bad, right? This is a level one student, and I must say, she is not a particularly talkative student. She's, I think, naturally quite reserved, and she certainly prefers writing to speaking. But here she is doing pretty high-level error analysis and talking about it pretty confidently. You'll notice during the video her eyes were kind of shifting because she had her her sentence frames open, the sentences she wrote earlier on her slide, she could have open and refer to as she spoke. But what I like is that she didn't feel the need to just read off the slide. She was able to talk as she was able to refer to her paper as she spoke. So it's clear she really, really understood what was happening. Oh dear. All right, so yeah, absolutely, exactly, using her resources. So I want to hear from you all now, fellow experts.
Hello.
What activities do you use to get your students talking online? Oh, I love that, golden lines. I hadn't heard that of that before, but that's a beautiful way to put it. I agree, it definitely helps to have preparation time, which is another reason I like Flipgrid. Awesome, thank you so much for sharing. The things you mention here, I want you to hold on to and keep in mind as we dive into the next topic here, which is assessment. And I'll start by inviting you to read this quote from the TOTOS position statement. I wish we had a whole hour to unpack this quote because it's so powerful. But I'll stick to just saying that for me, making space for alternative ways of knowing and doing mathematics definitely means finding alternatives to the traditional short answer, multiple choice math tests, that I'm sure many of us grew up with and which are still very prevalent in the math classroom today. We have to find alternatives because we know that those more traditional assessments are often discriminatory against many types of learners, including English learners. So I'm going to share with you the assessments I like to use in my class, starting with Pear Deck. Could I get a share of hands? This is in the reactions button at the bottom of your Zoom. Raise your hand if you're familiar with Pear Deck. All right, a few people. So Pear Deck is a really cool app that makes your regular old Google Slides interactive. So you can add prompts to your existing slideshow, and students can respond in real time, either by writing or drawing. So here you have an example of a Pear Deck prompt that's been added to a class slideshow, and the student has chosen to respond by typing. Here's another example of a student drawing how to solve a proportion. So it's a really quick way of getting insight into what your students are thinking. And it goes both ways. So you can also provide feedback through the Pear Deck in real time. Another assessment tool I love is Which One Doesn't Belong. You might be experiencing deja vu right now, but that's kind of the point. Assessments shouldn't be gotcha moments. They should have familiar structures so that students know how to do them, right? We want an accurate depiction of what students know and can do. We don't want to distract them with confusing directions or unfamiliar prompts. So your favorite activities that you do in class, the ones you mentioned in the chat just a few minutes ago, consider turning them into your assessments. They're probably the clearest window you have into what your students can do. Finally, my favorite type of summative assessment is asking students to become the teachers. So for every unit, students are tasked to explain that unit's big idea to someone else in whatever way they want. So they can make a virtual poster like this student did. They can make a video, which they very often do. And in fact, that's the next example I'm going to show you. Here is the summative assessment for the unit on functions. And here's a student explaining how to identify a function.
My first example, it is a relational function because in the map, no repeat the x values. In the graph, the vertical lines passes only for one point. So it is a function and relation.
All right. I'm going to stop here just for the question of time. But I love this video. I think it's so cool that she's explaining this really without any notes, and doing so with really specific tier three vocabulary, which she's using very accurately. Although I think she refers to the table as a mapping, but still pretty good.
My first sample, it is.
So I want to hear from you again, fellow experts. We talked about activities for talking. We've talked about getting to know our students. I'd love to know which assessment tools you like to use in your class. Yes, exit ticket, class pad, that's an awesome tool. Oh, I really like that idea, Maria, having students self-assess using the same rubric. Reflection, so important. Fantastic. Well, we have one more topic to touch on tonight. And that is family engagement. Take a moment to reflect on this quote, which is also from our latest position statement. I want to make sure we touch on this because family engagement is probably the most important factor in determining students' academic success. Thanks for coming, Sylvia. It's also the thing that I notice suffers the most under remote learning. And it makes sense. Teachers are overwhelmed right now. Like everyone, this has been a tough year. We're all dealing with loss of loved ones, loss of identity in many cases. So it's hard to do everything for ourselves, let alone for our students. But I've noticed that when we do get overwhelmed, the thing that kind of slips isn't the lesson planning or the grade book. It tends to be the connections between teachers and their students' families. So I want to end tonight by inviting you, if you are a classroom teacher, to consider dedicating 30 minutes of your work week to rebuilding that teacher-family connection by calling your students at home. I know you may feel like you don't have 30 minutes, but I promise you it's a worthwhile investment of your time. It's going to make a huge difference, especially if you call home, not just with bad news, you know, like Johnny was ghosting in class again, but calling home with good news or calling home with questions. Every time you call, you're showing that family how committed you are to that student's success and well-being, and you will most likely see that commitment returned in the classroom. The obvious challenge to this is that we don't all speak the same language as our students' families, but that's okay because we have amazing apps like Google Translate and Talking Points that can bridge that language barrier. Can I get another show of hands for how many of you are familiar with Talking Points? Oh my. Okay, we have one hand. Very good. All right, I have to insist, if there is one thing you take away from tonight's session, I really hope it's Talking Points because it is amazing. Talking Points is a totally free app that instantaneously translates text messages between two parties so that each party can send and receive messages in the language of their choice. It works very much like Remind, if you're familiar with that. So you don't have to use it on your phone. You could use it on your web browser. But it means you can have entire back and forth conversations with your students and their families in their language. In fact, it's probably best explained on this graphic they have on their website. So you can text in English, and the family will receive it, that same message, in their language. They can write back to you in their language, and you'll receive their message in English. It's amazing. So I hope you'll explore. Great question, Karen. You don't need the app. So even if the parent hasn't downloaded the app, they can still receive your text message. But it's certainly easier if both parties do. And thankfully, they provide a lot of resources available in other languages. So if you want to print out flyers to give to families that explains what the app does, they have it in literally 67 languages, I think. Do they have a voice option? That's a great question. I don't know. I believe it's only text-based, but it's certainly worth exploring. Here is their website. All right, friends and fellow experts, before we go tonight, I want to ask you one more question because you might know something I don't. How do you stay connected with your students and their families, especially from afar? I'd love to hear from you. Email's great. It's a good standby. I find many of the families I work with don't use email, which is why Talking Points is such a great alternative. But email is certainly nice. Oh, great. Yeah, class channels. In Slack is great for older learners, for sure. That spontaneous communication is so key for building those relationships. WhatsApp too, and I find all my students are on WhatsApp. Monthly newsletters. Awesome. Well, thank you all so much for sharing your knowledge and expertise with me tonight. I really appreciated hearing from you. I hope you saw something new tonight. Please feel free if you have any questions or you want to collaborate more, I'd love to. Please reach out to me by email. I'd love to collaborate with you more. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Maya. I got a ton out of this. I'm excited. I'm going to try this Talking Points. I think that's pretty cool. Before everyone goes, we just wanted to share a couple of things with you. And Maya, I did want to ask before I kind of show what I'm going to do. Would you be willing to share your PowerPoint? Because it had a lot of great suggestions on it. And absolutely. You know, the talking points and things like that. So I think in our follow-up email, we'll make sure that we send that along as well.
Absolutely.
I just wanted to kind of tag on to what Maya was talking about. I am a huge proponent of the language. And no matter what grade level you're speaking, I think you should be using precise mathematics. Fine to do the would you call it, dumbed down or the simplified language, but always use the correct math language. And I wanted to just show you another tool that I think is a great assessment tool. So Maya shared awesome tools like the Flip Grid. All of those are so great for, especially when you're in synchronous with the students working live, but I like to do assessments. My students are older, so we do assessments where they're working on their own at home. And one of the ones I like is classpad.net. And classpad.net is just a mathematics tool, but it allows you to provide lots of multiple representations, and they can really explain their work in a lot of different ways. So I just wanted to show you an example of what I'm talking about. So this is classpad.net. It does pretty much everything. You can do text and graphing and geometry and calculations. And I wanted to talk about what I have my students do is we use the text a lot because it has math type capabilities. And so this is text. And let's say we were doing functions where they were solving for a specific variable or something or multi-step. They can actually show all their work and write in, and this is where the language part comes in, actually write in the properties and the math words, precise math words that they're using. So I try to model that in my own examples when I'm working with them. I always call out the properties and words that we're using, the vocabulary. So I think that's really important so that when they are doing their own work, it kind of has become a habit that they know everything they do has to be justified and they have to use precise math language. So I just wanted to show you an example of how my math type works in the text, because a lot of the programs that you do, they can't, you know, show fractions properly. And that's one of the things I like about Classpad is you can do correct mathematical form and words. So this is just a problem. And I've kind of just shown the work here. And I just wanted to show you the last step. So in a text box, which when you pull up Classpad and you kind of hit anywhere, you can do calculations, graphing, geometry, data, tables, statistics, and text. So this is a text box. And let's say the students work, they're doing all their work and they're ready for the next line of this process where they're showing their work. Math type is really easy to get onto the text because it's just down here at the bottom. So I'm in the text box and I hit this square root of alpha, and that brings up, it brings up a math line. And so basically it's a line where they can use all the math templates and do precise math calculations and show them correctly. So now let's say they want to, they're going to multiply by the reciprocal on both sides, right? So we're going to do 15 over 13. And I am able to do that either using the template here or just with my computer and show my correct work precisely. So I'm just gonna, and so let's, if I use the template, I can now just type and show that my fraction here. And so I like it because it allows them to do really precise work and then explain it as well. So I am using, I'm not going to do this whole problem, but I want to just show that now the reason that I was able to do that is the multiplicative inverse. So Classpad's really nice because you can do things like use math type, use precise things. They can show all their work. They can write out their words. And then as we're thinking about assessment, they can also do it in multiple ways. So they have to verify their solution. I always have my students verify their work or explain their work in another way. So they have to do it at least two different ways so that they're always kind of making those connections between tables and graphs and words. And so if they wanted to verify the solution on the same place, they could just pull up a graph. And now I could show a different way to verify that that solution that I get is the same as the one that I did when I worked it out by pulling up a graph. So this is a really great tool if you want students to be showing lots of different ways that they're thinking about the mathematics. And so I could graph both sides of this as separate equations. So I'm just gonna type in each side as a separate equation and it will graph it. Let's graph the next one. So all I'm trying to do is just show you that here's another tool. Amaya gave us so many great tools, and this is just another, and it's free tool that allows students to really get engaged, use their vocabulary, show visuals, and make connections, and basically represent their mathematics in the ways that make sense to them. So here is a solution to the problem, which we didn't actually get all the way down to, but that is the solution, 75 over 13. That's all I wanted to show you is this really cool tool. It's free. If you go to the website, classped.net, which I think I can put in the chat panel, this is a free tool. I use it all the time with my students if we're doing something live, or I do it a lot for assessments because then they can show me lots of different ways. So Amy, turning things back to you.
Thank you, Karen. So as Karen mentioned, the classped.net is free, and we have additionally extended the advanced statistics as well as CAS functionality, and allowing that functionality to be free as well through the end of August. And then I just wanted also to talk about how Casio has always provided high quality and affordable technology for everyone. So we recently launched our newest graphing calculator, the FX9750G3. As you can see here, it is less than $60. And it has the same math templates as Karen was showing. Casio also created the Casio Cares program to support educators, parents, and students during this time of distance learning. This program gives free access to our calculator emulator software, which has now been extended through the end of August, and numerous free activities and videos to help support your curriculum. To learn more about our Casio Cares program, calculators, or software, visit CasioEducation.com. And now Erin will share some information about TOTOS. Erin?
Thanks, Amy. We hope everybody enjoyed tonight's presentation from current TOTOS member, Maya Gueron. Thank you, Maya. And tonight's presentation was aligned with our mission, TOTOS's mission to advocate for equity and high quality mathematics for all students. And on the slide, we've highlighted some of the things that TOTOS has to offer. We hope you take time to visit our website to learn more. If you go to the next slide, as one of the TOTOS 2021 conference organizers, we invite you to join us for our virtual conference, Activating Agency, Access, and Advancement in Mathematics, June 21 to 23. And we're excited to have Julia Aguirre and Christopher Childs as our keynotes, along with some many engaging sessions connected to our theme. We're also hosting a Leadership Institute, Change Agents Taking Action for Equity in Mathematics Education. More details are on our website, and registration is open now. We'll hope you join us, and thank you again for attending the sessions this evening, and thank you, Casio, for hosting us.
Thank you, Erin, and again, thank you, Maya, for sharing. Thank you, Erin, Linda, and TOTOS for your partnership, and thank you to those of you who joined us this evening. As a reminder, this webinar has been recorded and will be available on Casio Education's YouTube channel and on TOTOS's website. If you need a certificate of attendance, please respond to the follow-up email you will receive tomorrow. Thank you for joining us for this webinar, in this webinar series on distance learning and access. And we do still have a few more minutes, so if you are interested, we can stay on and feel free to type in the chat panel or turn on your microphone and ask Maya some additional questions you might have.
Thank you all for participating. It was really great to hear your ideas in the chat. And yes, I will send out the presentation in a follow-up email.
If you just send it, to Amy, Maya, and then we'll send it all in one big happy thing, because the recording will be up tomorrow with a link as well. So
thank you, Maya, so much for your expertise. Really appreciate it. And thank you, Erin. And thank you, Casio.
Thank you. All right. Doesn't look like thank anyone you. Has any questions. So I think we should all just say goodnight. All right. Have a nice evening.
Sounds good.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.